Good morning, everybody. I'm jumping the gun on the video a little bit. Sorry, Josh. We are glad to be back, and we're glad to be up here. I was telling a couple people, for anyone who doesn't know, we went on vacation south to our trailer outside of Paris, Ontario, and I was telling a couple people that we've really gotten used to the temperature up here, because down there, there was at least 5 or 6 days that it was like 36, 37, 38 Celsius, 42 after the Humidex. And we have air conditioning in our trailer. And those days, the kids are like, can we go to the park? Yes. Can you come with us? No. We're staying here where it's cold. And but it's great to be back. It's great to be home again. And we were saying, especially for the last week, we're like, we're looking forward to coming home again. So we're glad to be here. We're glad to be together. There's a bunch of faces I haven't seen in a while. So really glad to see you guys too. Welcome to everybody who's tuning in online. Why don't we stand and then we're going to enter into worship. God, thank you for this day. Thank you for this chance for us to be able to get together, for this chance for us to be able to worship you. And whether we're here in the building or we're at home taking it in online, we know that we're still worshiping the same God and we're still filled with the same Spirit. And so we just pray that you'd be with us wherever we are, that we'd feel your presence, God, and that we'd be able to offer up a song to you, offer up our lives to you as a living sacrifice, God. We just pray that as we worship, that we'd feel your presence with us, that we'd know that you accept our offering, not because of its quality, not because we're hitting the right notes or we're singing the right songs, but rather because we come before you with our hearts wide open to you. And so we just lift this whole service up to you. We just pray that each person would come away challenged, each person would come away changed, and that we'd further move forward and forward more and more for your kingdom. In your name we pray. Amen. The message that we carry is that God has made us glad. And we had an opportunity down south to need to be able to visit a hospital. Nothing for an emergency in our immediate family, but being down there and just seeing, especially down south, is a lot more intense measures of everything going on. And just being down there and seeing that, it really just reminded me of like how much hope we have in this world because of God. That if we were to hope in the world, that everything fades, everything falls apart. Even if society continues to rumble on, that ourselves and our bodies, they fall apart too. But the fact is that we worship a living God. God that brings us hope, a God that brings us joy, and a God that can meet us even in the lowest moments and give us rest and peace. And so just as we sing this next song, Lord, I need you, just pray that that would be our prayer today in the church, that we don't need anything more than we need God, that we don't need the food that we eat more than we need God. Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, Lord, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Oh, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. I really just want to open the floor for a moment here for praise reports. That will take up prayer requests later too, but if you just want to call out something that you're thankful to God for, and I'll repeat them into the mic just so that the people online can hear it too, but if there's something out there that you just want to praise God for. Praise for God's peace and mercy. Amen to that. Praise that his presence is our joy. Praise for the strength that he gives us. His unconditional love. Amen. For his protection. Big thing that's been on my heart praise wise is just the idea that God takes us right where we are, and that he has a standard for us. He wants us to get better, but he walks us there every step of the way. Any other praise reports? Yeah, praise that the fire stayed away. I heard about that. So some people are like, are you near that fire? I'm like, we were sort of online, so we didn't even know about it. Or sort of offline, rather. For his surprises and his mysterious ways. I've always said there's only two ways to respond to God. Thy will be done, or fine, have it your way. When we say the first one, we get a lot of those great surprises. Amen. So you're like new. Well, welcome to the community. And so we're going to sing the chorus here. And as we sing it, I just want that to be a prayer. That don't just sing the words, but as we sing, just say it to God in your heart. Even if you want to take a quiet moment and just pray while we sing. But let's make this more than a song. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Once with just our voices. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Just going to enter into a time of prayer right now. But we're going to do it a little bit differently. I really encourage everyone. I try to not say things like the Spirit of the God, our Spirit of God has entered this room, because the truth is He's always here. We have opened ourselves. And so in this moment, I'm just going to play quietly, and I just encourage you, in your seat, just cry out to God. Just have your own personal altar moment right now. And if you're here in a group with someone, feel free to just pray with them. If you're by yourself, just reach out to someone else in the room and pray for that person. But God's presence is not something that I hand out from the front. It's something that we all take for ourselves, wherever we are. So go ahead and take a moment and just pray. Thank you. God, we just come before you today, God. And we just lay our hearts down. And we ask you to come in. God, I just want to pray for each person here. That wherever they're at, God. That whether they've had an amazing last few years or they're in deep, deep need. We know that everything we have is ashes compared to just being in your presence, God. And so, God, we pray that we would just open ourselves more and more to you, God. I want to pray for the people with heavy hearts, the people who come into your presence, God, feeling more broken than they ever have, God. We know that blessed are the poor in spirit, God. Blessed are the broken. Blessed are those who mourn because they'll be comforted. Blessed is anyone who has a need to be in your presence, God, because we can find you. God, we just pray that we would see you do amazing things again and again and again. Promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won.
Amen.
For you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me. Our voices.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing.
Pour out our praise. We pour out our
in our lives. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Great are you. Great are you, Lord.
God, you are the name above all names, God. And we love to just stand in your presence, God. We love to learn more about you, and we love to see you more and more. God, just thank you for that awesome peace and that awesome joy that just comes from being in your presence, God. And God, we just mirror the words of David when he says that the one thing that I ask, one thing that I seek, is to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. God, we just want to lift the rest of this service up to you, God. As we go into the Word, as we go into what you have for us, God, help us to continue to have the same kind of open heart. Help us to receive your Word with joy and gladness, God. And as we said before, God, thank you for taking us exactly where we are. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
So, for anyone who has kids or has had kids, you know when you go a long period of time between seeing other people's kids and you're like, man, they've gotten so big, but the parents are like, I have no idea what you're talking about. I had a mini experience with that a couple minutes ago. I'm totally going to pick on you guys. When you guys came in, and I remember I've seen you guys a couple times during the pandemic and everything, but I remember this clearly, is that you used to fit in one pew. And you don't anymore. So it's great to have you out, but I noticed that. It's like, especially Elijah. Like, are you taller than him now? Yeah, okay. That doesn't surprise me. So welcome, everybody. I am back. I'm really fuzzy again, Josh. Battery. Test, test. I just switched it. We'll try. If I keep fuzzing out, I'll grab that mic. I am back from my vacation. Yeah, this is driving me nuts.
I am back from my vacation. We went south for a few weeks to a trailer we own in a little camp called Brayside Pentecostal Camp. Has anyone here heard about that? You have. You have too. I didn't know you knew about it. You're like, we're going to talk later if you've heard about Brayside. It's one of my favorite places. And we spent some time there. Had fun, got rest. Like I said earlier, it was way, way too hot down south. And we were trying to convince our neighbors when we were having a bonfire at like 10 o'clock at night and it was pitch black. We're like, this not like that up north. It's still like we could go golfing at 10 o'clock at night. It's still light. So we're glad to be back. And the message I really have in my heart today is this message I call unity and maturity. And growth and the body of Christ, and what it means to be a growing church and what it means to grow. And one thing I talk about a lot, I use it as an illustration a lot, is I have a bad leg. And I'm only like 37, and I've had a bad leg for, I want to say, about 13 or 14 years. It's been a while. I think I hurt my leg even before I got married. And
The story I love to tell people about how I hurt my leg is I fell playing ping pong with a 10-year-old in the basement of a church. But actually, I had previously injured it prior to that playing football. And if you've ever played football, there's a move you can do called a button hook where you take a step and you're moving this way and you plant your leg and you push back off again to go fast in the other direction. And when I planted my leg and I pushed, I heard a really loud snap and I hit the ground. And they got it on video, and I wish I still had that video. I don't know. It was cool to watch because the camera's like 60 yards away and there's a bunch of guys yelling and it's just background noise. And all I hear is just and me hit the ground. But that's when I originally hurt my leg. But what I didn't do is something about it. That I hurt my leg. I limped for a couple weeks. And then it was okay for a little while, but it kept giving out on me. But I didn't do anything about it. I didn't go to the hospital. I didn't get it checked out. I didn't get MRIs. I found out later that I had tore my meniscus at that point. And so my knee, I'm pointing at like the one doctor in the room. that I damaged my knee, and it kept giving out because I tore this meniscus, and it was this meniscal tear that eventually led to me putting my leg out for the count, playing ping pong. And so I became like an evangelist to, if you have something hurt, go to the doctor. Go get it checked out. You don't want to wait. I had an injury that was relatively repairable, but because I had taken my time and made it worse, it became unrepairable. And so I was constantly telling people, something hurts, go see the doctor. If you think that there's something wrong, just go talk to somebody, get it checked out. These problems can be solved. And so today I want to read from Ephesians 4, and we're going to be kind of covering a lot of material from verse 1 to verse 16. And so if you want to turn in your Bible, I'll be reading from it as well. But Paul starts this section off in Ephesians 4, verse 1, and he says this, "As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling that you have received." Now, I told this story about how I messed my leg up, and it was me. It wasn't like I did something bad and I couldn't fix it, now I have to live with it. That I'd done this thing to my leg, and because I didn't address it, I couldn't go back. This is not that. That when we talk about living a successful life for the Lord, do we say, you know what, I had a great life for God. I spent a lot of my last years in prison being tortured. Do we say that? We have a totally different concept of what it means to be successful. But Paul is saying, you know, look at my life and me as a prisoner. I want to call you in the same way to live a life worthy of the calling that you have received. And this is a radical idea. And he doesn't say here, make sure you earn it. He's not saying, you know what, I want you to live the kind of life that now that you have this grace, you've got to pay it back. That's not what Paul is saying here. He's not saying this is a debt owed and it doesn't count until you've put your part in. This is not make sure you earn it. This is make sure you don't waste it. Make sure that you understand that this isn't a free pass. It's a fresh start. And Paul is in chains, but he considers his life very successful before the Lord. And I've told people before, would you hire? I talked to some friends who were hiring pastors, and I said, you know, if somebody put in a resume like Paul, would you hire this person? I've been in a bunch of shipwrecks. I've been tortured by the local government authorities for breaking the rules. I got bit by a snake once. That was fun. Like, would you look at this person's resume and say, this person is successful? We wouldn't. But the fact is that God's idea of success, God's idea of maturity is totally different than ours. And I think Paul, in the coming verses here, that he really takes a deep dive into this idea of what it means to be mature, and it starts with this idea of unity. And that's what I wanted to talk about today. And so let's keep in mind that Paul here, he's saying,
you know, that we have a fresh start in God. Let's make sure we don't waste it. The Bible says at one point that, you know, some people are going to get into heaven basically by the skin of their teeth, that all the great stuff and all the bad stuff that we've done is going to get piled up at the end of time and it's going to be burned. And the things that are worthwhile, the things that are good, are going to remain and they're going to be for us treasures in heaven. But some people are going to make it like someone who's just escaped from a fire. And have you ever seen someone just escape from a fire before? I was at home in Newmarket years ago, and there was a big house fire down the street. And I remember walking down the street to see if there's anything I could help with. And this woman was just standing outside of her house watching everything she owned burn. And the fact is that she survived. She made it. But it wasn't joy on her face. It was sorrow. We don't want to be the person that seems like we just made it out of a fire with what we have on our backs. And so Paul says, make sure you live a life worthy of the calling that you've received. But then he follows it right up, and he gives a great definition of what that looks like. And that's verse 2. He says, be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make sure to keep the unity of the Spirit. Oh, lost my place. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. And so for Paul, this is what this is. Living a life worthy of the calling is this idea of doing whatever we can to live in unity. And that sounds so opposite to what we would make a list of. That if you had to sit down and say, you know what, I'm going to make out a list of what I think we need to do to be mature, that wouldn't be an automatic thing that I would have picked. You know, God could have said, you know, if you don't follow the right rules, you'll miss out. Or make sure that you're singing the right songs. Make sure that you dress the right way. He could have said those things. But he starts off by saying, you know, be completely humble and patient and strive for this unity in the Spirit. And so to Paul, a worthy life, a life that God rewards, is a life that starts with unity powered by love. And here's a little bit of a secret. The reason is because that's really hard for us. That is like the single strongest thing that we as Christians can show the world. That we can show them our moral rightness. We can show them power. We can show them a good life. But, you know, Jesus himself said, they'll know that you're my disciples by what? By the love that you have for each other. And so that is the worthy thing that God calls us all to, is this idea of unity powered by love. And that's going to be hard because there's lots of problems in every church. I was talking to some friends while I was on vacation down south, and they were talking about this one church had seen a couple splits and people were leaving, and then people left this church. And then now a year or two later, they were at a new church, and they were having new problems at this new church. And we're in this temptation to want to try and find a perfect church. We're in this temptation to want to try and find a place where we feel connected, where we feel like we belong, where we feel like everything's going great. But the fact is we make that place. We don't just find that place. I told this person, I'm like, isn't that surprising? The person who finds problems leaves and then tends to find more problems. Because the thing that's not lacking isn't unity. It's conflict management. It's learning how to deal with the problems when they come. You can have a united marriage and still have problems. Because unity isn't about a lack of problems. It's about the presence of love powering through them. So this is something that's really difficult for us as the body, is to be this entity of united love. But that's what God calls us to here. And so why is unity so important to God? Why is it that Paul is saying, you know what, like above all, live a life worthy of the calling by being united in love with each other? Why is it so important? Well, if we read Ephesians 4, verses 4 to 6, it says, you know, there is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. And so Paul is saying, why is unity so important? Because the things that save us connect us. The things that we praise God for, other people do too. And that should be the most important thing to us. One thing that's been happening a lot in churches everywhere lately is division, especially division over the pandemic. And we've all got perspectives on answers to questions about vaccines and rules and restrictions and regulations and numbers and whether things are being falsified or they're true, whether the government's taking care of us or they're not, whether we're on our own and we're being persecuted or we're being given a lot of grace. We all have answers about this. And until you can find me a verse that says you're welcome in when you've got the right perspective on vaccines, I'm not going to allow that to be a thing. Not in my life. Because it's about unity. That I have a conviction about the truth. And I have a friend who is on the opposite side of that spectrum for me. And I make a very conscious effort to say, this is not a unity-breaking issue. That there cannot be unity-breaking issues because we both worship the same God. And you know, that's been my heart through this whole thing, is that we're always going to have things to talk about. We're always going to have areas where we disagree, and there's always going to be areas where we're right and we're wrong. But Paul says, you know, strive for unity in love. And so if we just tell ourselves, you know, this is not a unity-breaking issue, that these things, maybe you agree with what's happened, maybe you've agreed with some choices that churches have been making, and maybe you don't. But it's not a unity-breaking thing. The district superintendent for the Western Ontario District of the PAOC is a wonderful human being named Laurie Gibbons, and he's going to be retiring at the end of the year. We're at the end of whenever our next conference is. And I got a chance to see him speak. And he said, you know what we really feel called to when we retire? Is to just be supportive old people. And everyone kind of chuckled when he said that. And he's like, no, I'm serious. Like, I want to be that old couple in the church that we show up and we go, you know what? I don't have any idea what the youth ministry department is doing right now. And I'm finding like things all over the church. But God bless you for trying. I'm going to support you. Because it was about unity and love. And so Paul's saying this one spirit, this one Father is over us all. And that's good enough. We don't need anything else. We don't need to have the same language. We don't need to have the same skin color. We don't need to have the same culture, the same answers to other questions. You know, are they a believer? Then they're family. Are we worshiping the same God? Then we're together. And you know what? He also says that there's one spirit that powers everything, and it calls us to one hope. And so everything that when we step out and we do something in the power of God, it's the same spirit behind us that might be backing up somebody else that we disagree with. And that's challenging. I've seen, and again on this whole pandemic issue, I've seen pastors preach and express opinions that are opposite to what I would think. And it's really difficult for me to say, but you know, the same spirit runs through that person too. That's a challenge. It's really hard for us. And so this is what Paul's called us to, is the same spirit that can power all of this. And we're called to this one hope, that this end goal, this end game that God has for every one of us, it's not in this life. That when we die, we stand before God in perfection. That's when we've received the prize that he's called us out for. Until that point, we're still running. Until that point, we're still training. And that's the hope that he's called us to. And when we realize that, your life changes. When you realize that, you know what, it's my progress in the kingdom that I make that is the real prize. I've been reading through a book, and we're reading through it as a board, and they had this example in one chapter of this person who got a terminal cancer diagnosis. But through the terminal cancer diagnosis, that they were able to spend more time praying with other believers, that they were able to encourage other believers, that they went on like a speaking tour, just talking to people about how, you know what, this is what's going on in my life, but I praise God. And more people have come to the Lord through their ministry in their suffering than before. And so he can stand there with every ounce of honesty in his heart and say, praise God for this in my life. Because it's not the end game. That this, when we stand before the Lord in perfection, that's the end game. Everything else is temporary. And so Paul fights for this idea of unity because we look to the same God, we're powered by the same Spirit, and we walk towards the same hope. But why love? Why not the right answers? I'm a school person. I'm an education person. I could just collect degrees as like a training thing. I just love going to school. I love writing papers. And I love being able to do stuff like that. And why love? Why not the right answers to the right questions? Well, in the truth, looking at verse 11 to 13, it says here, Christ gave himself, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and teachers, to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. And so why love? Well, Paul here is saying this unity powered by love, this is the vehicle that drives growth. This is the thing that God gives us to help each other out and to sharpen each other, is this idea of unity through love. And the amount of times that I've been encouraged by a close relationship with someone else, like I can read a book and that's fine, I can take a test and that's fine, but many of those life-changing moments have just been in connection with someone else when they say something and they go, you know, I feel like God wants me to tell you this. Or they just say, you know what, this is what I think is a good idea. That those moments of growth, those moments of expansion in the kingdom come through those everyday relationships. That's why I constantly encourage people to go and get into small groups outside of Sunday mornings. That I've listened to some of the most gifted pastors, especially now that we have this thing called Right Now Media at our church, that we can go on and we can listen to whoever we want. And we can listen to the most gifted pastors. But the fact is that if your faith is entirely fed and powered by me 30 minutes a week, it's not going to go well. We need to be constantly connected to each other. That we fight for this idea of being able to connect together as the body. And we look at Acts, and we read Acts 2, and we read Acts 10, and it says, you know, never give up the assembling of the saints. But at the time, they weren't talking about church services. They didn't have church services. They had small groups in their homes and meals. And so whenever Paul says, make sure you always get together, he's talking about that. He's saying, make sure to connect with each other. Make sure to learn and grow and study outside of these times. And so you know what that means is that if love is the vehicle of growth, if this unity and connection is the way that we all grow, then that means that we are all agents of growth. All of us. Because it says, the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature. And then later on it says, From him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. So unity in love is what grows a church. That any of the ministries we have here at the church that do well have other people behind them, more than just me. That there's people who have a compassion to see things done. That our youth group does really well because we've got Josh, who's got a great heart. Yeah, I'm calling you up. Too bad. Don't mute me. Who's got a great heart for this, and he's a lot more fun than me. I'm not great at fun. He's a lot more fun than me. Our kids' ministry does well because we have volunteers behind it that care. Our women's ministry has volunteers behind it that care. That when each part steps up to do its work, the body grows. And there's a sidebar here. This is one of the only verses, this is my big passion when it comes to pastors. This is one of the only verses in the Bible that really talks about what a pastor is supposed to do in a church. And if you missed it, I'll read it again. So Christ gave himself the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers to equip his body for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. It's always been on my heart that, like, as a pastor, I'm a tool giver. That I am equipping people, I'm coming alongside leaders, and I'm saying, what can I do to help you out with this? I'm a tool giver, but we all build. We all get to work, and we do our things to help the body grow. And that unity and love is the strongest way that that can happen. I was in a church once, and they were talking about putting a membership directory, because the church didn't have membership, but like a directory of people who considered this church their home. And the directory would have been huge, like 400 or 500 names. And the people who were pushing for it were saying, you know what, we really should have this directory just so that, like, I could have a basic understanding of what's going on. Maybe if we had like a prayer section, someone could post up a prayer request. And we could read it and go, okay, yeah, I'll pray for that person. I don't know who they are, but I'll pray for them. And there's nothing wrong with that. But the thing that they were pushing for at this church is take care of the people around you. And so I had a conversation with this person once. I had to get some contact information from them. And I come over and I'm talking to them. And I said, you know, can you give me this information? It was a youth thing and I had their kids. And I'm like, just in case there's an emergency, I need to be able to get a hold of you. And as I'm talking with them and we're chatting for a little bit, he goes, you know what, if we had this directory, because he's one of those guys, he always like pushes a button. If you had this directory, you wouldn't have to come out here and talk to me. And I'm like, you're right. If I had this directory, I wouldn't have to come out here and talk to you. And he goes, okay, touche. But there's nothing wrong with directories. There's nothing wrong with prayer lists or chains or anything like that. They're all wonderful. But it's unity. It's being intimately connected to other people is when God really starts to move. When we're not just praying for people that are a name on a screen, but that we actually know these people. We spent time with them. And so we're all agents of growth. And if we take this conviction in our hearts and we say, I am here to help my church grow, that's how the church grows. And it's going to take forgiveness. That's why it's unity and love, because people make mistakes. If at some point in the church, if we ever go and hire a youth pastor, I am going to do my darndest to make sure that he or she gets forgiven for all the things that they're probably going to do that I did as a youth pastor. One of my youth kicked a hole in a wall in the basement of our church, and I felt awful. And one of them broke a light in a sanctuary, and I felt awful. The youth pastors are trying their hardest to reach a group. And we need unity and love to back them up. And so the walls, the chairs, the paint, the carpet, these shouldn't be issues that cause us to put someone else on another side of an issue than us. There is no them. There is only us. And so the end goal here, we talked about how we have this one hope that we all move towards. And Paul's been talking about unity, he's been talking about love, And it's all this underpinning and this assumptions of forgiving people more and more and more all the time and looking past things. You know, the Bible says that, you know, love covers a multitude of sins. How does this lead to maturity? Because we as like a Western civilization, our concept of maturity is we know more. Our concept of maturity is we have more answers to more questions. And that is a philosophical position we have as a culture. It's not a biblical position. That we need to grow. We need to learn. We need to have answers prepared for why we have hope. But Paul here is saying, be united constantly in love, and then what? Verses 14 to 16, it says this. Then we'll no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Have you ever met a person like that? If you're on Facebook, you have. The person who just shares one thing and then like a week later they share something totally different and you're like, but they're not the same. They're opposites actually. And they feel like they're just there to stir the pot. And maybe some people are. But maybe they're like a boat lost at sea, being tossed back and forth by the waves. Instead, verse 15, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. And so that's this end goal here, that we're growing as a body, not just that each one of us is doing well, but that all of us are doing well. And when one part mourns, all of us mourn. When one part rejoices, all of us rejoice. And you know, what if we had, and I've said this before, what if we had this conviction as a church that we're not doing well until everyone's doing well? That maybe we're having this moment with the Spirit, but we look over and someone else doesn't seem like they're reaching it. We're not doing well until we're doing well, all of us. And when we have that love, when we have that chance to say, you know what, I'm here for you. What can I do to help? One thing that's been really stressful for me is my kids and bringing them to church services. Now, they're not here just because we just made the long trip and we just want to give them a bit of a buffer. But when we were south, we got a chance to attend some church services. And we have those kids that, like, if you're ever in a church and it looks like one kid's going to eat another one, those are our kids. And especially with lack of kids ministry, those are our kids. And so I remember sitting, and I'm trying to give Catherine a break, and I'm trying to hold on to both of the kids, and Caleb's climbing back and forth, and he's got a book. And Sadie's got it in her head that she's in, like, screaming phase. So I'm trying to get her to be quiet, and I'm trying to get Caleb to sit down, and Elizabeth's at something else, so she's good. And I'm just stressed, and I'm panicked. And this person comes over to me, and they say, you know what, I just want you to know your kids are awesome. Unity in love. I'm tearing up right now even remembering this. I don't even know if I told my wife about it. That's what makes a difference. Unity in love. And so what can we do to hold that deep conviction that, you know what, we're not all good until we're all good? And that leads to maturity. Paul says, not only do we have this foundation where we won't be tossed back and forth. And that's one of our fears. If we're honest with ourselves, deep down, we're afraid that maybe we're going to get led astray. Maybe something that we think or do or try isn't going to be 100% on, and we're going to fall away. But Paul is saying, you know what, if you're fighting for this unity and love, if you're fighting to be a person that grows the body, you will not be this person, this child, being tossed back and forth in the waves. But instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become, in every respect, the mature body of Christ. And again, verse 16, I read it earlier. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. And so that's the conviction that we hold here as a church. And so we're calling us together through this coming season
is that this idea of church health through each part doing its work. And so I'm going to invite you to pray with us today. And as you pray, part of this process is in bringing ourselves to the altar. That, you know, Paul in Romans says, you know, we're to offer ourselves up as a living sacrifice, and that is our true and our spiritual act of worship. And we think that means come out and sing songs and give money. But, you know, when Paul was saying offer yourself as a living sacrifice, he was talking to a culture that practiced sacrifice. And at that point, he wasn't saying offer a living sacrifice. When he was talking to these people, they would come, they would bring an animal, and the best animal. Because the Jews had rules and laws that said it has to be spotless. It can't be lame in any way. It can't be sick in any way. You've got to bring the best of the best to this table and give it away. He's not saying offer a sacrifice, and that is your true and spiritual act of worship. He's saying offer yourself as a sacrifice. So it's going to be hard for us. It's going to be a difficult walk because everything that's worth having is worth fighting for. And so that's what God calls us to. That's what Paul's talking about in this text, is this idea that if we want maturity, if we want health, if we want growth, if we want to see this one spirit and this one hope and this one power that moves through all of us, it's unity and it's love. So we're going to pray. And this is where the living sacrifice part comes in. The Bible says that when you come before the Lord to bring a sacrifice, but then you remember that someone else has something against you, or by proxy, you have something against someone else, put your gift down, walk away, go work it up. So this is our sacrifice moment. Here's our practical. Is that we're going to get together, we're going to pray here. And if you're in the building or if you're online and you just feel like God's bringing this thing to your heart and saying, you know what, there's a part of the body where I have not been an agent of unity. There's a part of the body where I have not done the thing I need to do to make someone else feel welcome. Then I want you to pray about that thing, and then I want you to try and go do something about it. Because that's what grows the body. That's what mature faith looks like. When we're willing to put ourselves down, to be completely humble and gentle and patient and bear with one another in love. And that's what it looks like to make every effort to keep this unity of the Spirit through this bond of peace. So if God brings that thing to your mind, I want you to try and do something about it. And if you're near someone that you trust, tell them, because the enemy's got a really great way of taking those away from us. It's called busyness, that we're going to say it and we're going to come out of this place with this conviction, and then we're going to go and make lunch and we're going to talk about what we want for lunch, and then we're going to cook for a while, and then maybe we're going to take a nap in the afternoon, or if you have kids, you're not sorry, and it goes away. So if you have someone that you trust, talk to them about it. Say, you know what, this is what the Spirit's laid on my heart. And if the person's in the room, just walk over and deal with it. Great. Then check. Go make your lunch. But let's pray. God, we thank you for today. We thank you for this word. And we thank you that you've called us to this unity in the body, God. We thank you that you love us so much that you're willing to take care of us no matter what we've done, God. That as we sang earlier in worship, that we can just come to you because you're great. Help us to hold that same standard to other people. God, that we know that your word says that the measure we use against others is the one that's going to be used against us. God, help us to have such a wide and a deep and a long measure that we hold towards other people. God, I just want to pray for each person in this room. If there's something that they hold against another person, even if it's legitimate, even if it's real and deep and painful, we know growth comes from putting down the things that hurt and taking up the things that heal. And so, God, we just pray that each one of us, that we would put those things down and that we'd move towards the unity that you've called us to in the body. Thank you for each person here. Thank you for the people in our church who have committed themselves to being agents of growth through unity and love. And we thank you for the great things that we've seen out of those, and we believe that we're going to see more and more after that. And God, we just pray for our church and we pray for our town and our province as things are starting to open back up again. And with the coming conversations that I believe are going to be happening across all churches about rules and regulations, about the impact of the pandemic, we just pray for unity. God, we pray for peace. God, help us to show the world that you said, you know, that we are your disciples because we love each other, no matter where we fall. And so, God, I lift each person up to you today. I just pray that you'd be with them every single day of the week, not just today. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay, thank you very much, everybody, for coming out. We hope you have a great week, and God bless.